So good morning, all attendees. It's 9 a.m. We are going to be starting our series of online collaboration tools and practices you can use today with our first episode hosted by Mark Fraunfelder, our editorial director and research director here at Institute for the Future, author of many books. And Mark, you might want to add to my bio of you, but I'll keep it simple with the IFTF references.
Yeah, that's fine.
You're so accomplished, it's hard to keep track of everything. But also, this first episode will be featuring Howard Rheingold, IFTF's Distinguished Fellow and artist, author of several best-selling books on the subject of virtual community, titles including Smart Mobs and Smart Net, How to Thrive Online, a pioneer of pedagogy and online peer learning methodology, a teacher of social media issues and literacies at UC Berkeley and Stanford, a technology pioneer, a futurist, and he will be sharing some of his more recent writings on the topic as well. So I'll let you two take off on the conversation.
Great. So I'm really excited to be speaking with Howard. We've known each other for an awfully long time. I think we met probably in the late 80s when Howard was an editor at the Whole Earth Review. And then we communicated a lot on the Well, which was a, I guess, conferencing system or text-based bulletin board, online bulletin board, which was my introduction to online communities. Howard later wrote a book called The Virtual Community that was partially inspired by his experiences on the Well. Howard's gone on to really become an expert in online collaboration, conferences, teaching online, things like that. And so, Howard, what I wanted to talk to you today is about what we know now is that social isolation is like a really important component of flattening the epidemiological curve of the coronavirus. And so think people are canceling conferences, schools are meeting online. So for people who are concerned about this, what are some of the starting things they need to start thinking about if they want to replace these face-to-face meetings with an online substitute?
Okay, in the long run, let's dismiss this argument. Online is not a replacement for a face-to-face classroom or a face-to-face conference, but in the kind of circumstances we find ourselves with social isolation, it can be an effective substitute. The problem is know-how. All of these teachers in all of these colleges are being thrown into the deep end. Suddenly your class is online with really no training in it. And the good news is that there are a lot of tools available, like the one that we're using now, that are either free or inexpensive, and they're not that difficult to use. The not as good news is that you really need to sort of know how to do it. And I'd say let's take those two different instances. One is the face-to-face conference. There really is no substitute for it. Face-to-face conferences, especially the kind that happen year after year, they're really the locus of communities, and so much happens in the interpersonal interactions that people have informally, and you can't really effectively replace that. However, you can do a pretty good job of emulating a face-to-face conference with online tools. Instead of transporting thousands of people, thousands of miles for 2 or 3 days in a convention center or a hotel conference center, you do it online, and you have a mixture of synchronous and asynchronous media. in the late 1990s, I had a consulting firm that helped some companies try to pioneer this. And I wrote down what I remembered of how you could go about doing that in a post. And I think the post is in the text chat here, and it'll probably be on the webpage. It's worth experimenting with the cost of mounting a conference for 1,000 or 3,000 people is so many orders of magnitude greater than hiring some people who know what they're doing, using some good technology, and organizing something online. It's not something that you can do overnight. Ideally, you would want to have several months in advance, but we don't have several months. It can be organized, and you have keynotes. Speakers can upload videos now. I think one of the main differences between online and face-to-face is that you have a captive audience for a plenary keynote at a face-to-face conference. You've got all these people watching on screens, and particularly doing it asynchronously, you really need to keep it a lot shorter than a face-to-face keynote, which is usually 45 minutes to an hour or more. I'd say both for lecturing to students online and for participating in an online conference, you want to keep your videos to 20 minutes. And you know, sometimes support, scaffolding, two or 3 minute videos can be really helpful.
And why is that? Do people have different kinds of attention spans for mediated experiences?
I think it's that you're a captive audience. Your mind can wander when you're sitting in a big hall and there's a speaker at the front, but you're probably not going to get up and go out and go to the bathroom or go to the kitchen or online. I think people are used to having a shorter attention span. Mm-hmm. But that's one of the advantages of asynchronous media. You can pause it. So, for example, if you think of having a forum or a message board, web-based, multimedia, as a kind of substitute for the keynote, workshop, informal hallway interaction, you could have, for example, threads in which the first post is a video from the keynoter, and then the keynoter comes back. Again, this is asynchronously. Everyone can choose their own time to participate and participates in a conversation thread that can be text, but can also include graphics and videos with the other participants. Instead of it taking place during a 1 hour slot, then that could be spread over a week. Similarly for workshops. I think this applies both to the online conference and the online classroom, is that audio video with some text chat like we're doing right now is really a great way of being present with other human beings. You know, when it's sort of the good news and the bad news about text is that it flattens affect. Everybody is the same. They're just text. Well, you know, there's some advantages to that sometime, but we are really evolved to look and hear and pick up on nonverbal cues. I think every teacher knows that when you're standing in front of a classroom and you say something and nobody understands it, you see that on their faces immediately. So I think that, of course, the advantage of asynchronous is that people can choose what time to participate. Synchronous, you need to have regular times. And I think that's one of the important planning aspects of an online course, is to have a clear schedule for people. You can have online office hours. You can just leave a video room open for certain hours of the day. And you can have designated times for live sessions. And in that regard, I, in my own practice, I really hold the lecturing to 20 minutes and leave the rest of the hour for interactive activities. And I really experimented with this for years. I taught online blended learning courses at Berkeley and Stanford for 10 years and learned that you need to have activities in which people participate rather than just have them listening to you. I mean, mm-hmm. you could put your lecture on YouTube for that.
So the activities, it's some kind of a prompt for them to engage in a discussion or an exercise.
Well, that's one of the things that I evolved with my learners online, which is I put up a whiteboard. At the beginning, I asked people what were the kind of different roles that we could play. And ultimately, we came up with a number of them that we used time and again. One of them is searchers. You could have a team of two or three people who search on themes that come up in the discussion and enter the URLs in the chat. And then another team of two or three people would download the chat and extract those URLs and then write a two or three sentence contextualizing description of what's in that. And then they would pass that over to a page master or wiki master who would take those contextualized URLs, a link to a transcript of the chat, a link to a video of the meeting for people who couldn't attend, and then some other things that I can describe. But every live session would then have a page that would have all these things. We also had a lexicon team, and that was very useful in that there would be two people who would identify words and phrases from the discussion, from the texts, from the lectures, put them on a wiki page, and then during the week, the rest of us in the class would expand those Wikipedia style. So there would be a link to the lexicon as well, and there's mind mapping. So there's a number of different things that people can be doing during the lecture, and I think people who are accustomed to meetings like this one know that there's a conversation going on in the text chat that can be very useful.
The thing I like about this approach is that you are kind of engaging everyone in the learning experience. So they are, I don't want to say forced to pay attention, but they're given a role that encourages them to pay attention. And the end result is something that's useful for everyone too.
Yeah.
Really cool.
Well, you know, I think that's the center of what I and others call co-learning. That, you know, it's not about, you know, Paulo Freire talked about the banking theory of learning, that the teacher's got this information in our heads and we're gonna transfer that to the students' heads. It's really more about trying to make meaning of the syllabus together. And I think, you know, every good teacher knows that there's time to just shut up and let the learners talk about it. And, you know, we could tell them in 1 minute, but they might spend 10 minutes figuring it out for themselves. And that learning is going to stick a lot better.
One thing I wanted to talk to you about is what you think the role of VR is in all of this. I have a 16-year-old daughter who uses VR chat, and just the other night she told me she plays accordion. She met someone there who plays guitar, who lives in Northern England, and they had like a little jam session using VR chat. Do you think that VR is going to make virtual learning, online collaboration, online meetings better, or is it not a necessary thing to have?
Well, it certainly would be better if everybody was able to do it. But, you know, VR was going to be the next big mass medium since I wrote a book about it in 1991. So certainly there's a hardcore now, a lot of gamers, and early adopters use it. I used to do a certain amount of invited lectures in Second Life, and there was an interesting sense of presence there because, of course, people had avatars. people didn't really make, I didn't think good educational use of Second Life most of the time. It was transferring a classroom where there is a lecturer and students who would listen and ask questions to a different environment. I always thought that if you had a situation that was uniquely addressable by a navigable 3D world, let's say you're studying the architecture, wouldn't it be great to do a walkthrough of Notre Dame or the pyramids? Or you're studying molecules, wouldn't it be great to walk around inside a giant molecule? But again, these are really tiny, and what we're in right now is a pretty large scale switch. So yeah, sure, maybe in the future. Right now, what can we do with people who have only smartphone connections? And I think I'll have to say we're being forced into this situation. The colleges and the universities are just shutting down. But there are real equity issues about people who don't have access. And, you know, I don't know how to address that. I just have to say that is an issue here. I'm not trying to paint this as a panacea. I'm trying to say we are being forced into this situation. How do we best address it? And I think there's a lot of great practices. You could use simple technology. Jesse Stommel had a best practices thread on Twitter in which he talked about just having the learners write little mini essays on Medium. And I'll have to say that one easy way is WordPress. That if you don't want to configure a forum, and I'm all for forums, and I detailed that in the posts, and that the well that we met on was a forum, but now we've got multimedia forums. But you can have great conversations in comment threads on WordPress, and there's a lot of work out there about adopting WordPress. You can make it a hub for a class. In fact, I'm going to put I still keep alive the page for the last course I taught at Stanford as kind of an example, socialmediaissues.net. I just learned how to create a class hub on WordPress. You can create pages that have your syllabus. You can have you can syndicate individual students' blogs. You know, what I did was I asked my students to create their own WordPress blogs, and then they were syndicated on the main page. But you could just have one blog and multiple bloggers. So you could use WordPress. You could use Zoom like we're using it now. There's another one called Big Blue Button that's free and open source that does a good job and records as well. There are a number of different platforms to use. I think what's important is to engage the students, but also to do what they call scaffolding it. You really have to let them know exactly what it is you're going to be doing and why. I mean, I think you could go back 6,000 years and students would know exactly what to do in a classroom, where to sit, who's in charge. It's different online. So I actually did screenshot by screenshot how to use a forum, how to make a blog post. And I also told them why, that the forum was for the group conversation and the voice of the group, and that the blogs, we could have conversations around blogs, but the blog was the voice of the individual. And I think that being able to have both the voice of the individual and the voice of the group together with some kind of collaborative work gives you a lot of different entries into dealing with the material.
So, in the spirit of co-learning, let's open this up a little bit to some of the attendees. I have a question here from an attendee. Beyond Zoom, are there other technologies that can help substitute experiential courses? I teach at a university and deliver leadership-based interpersonal dynamics courses. Much of this course focuses on body language cues and emotional expression. As the screen quotes, flattens effect, as you say, what ideas could you offer to overcome this challenge?
Okay, you know, I'm not going to claim expertise on this, but you know, when just in the text-based world, it's a cliche that we don't pick up cues from tone of voice and body language and facial expressions, but you get a lot of that online. I think one of the things that I really got a great deal of value out of was inviting the learners to participate in the teaching. So I would have lists of required readings that everyone was required to read, and recommended readings on each week's theme for people who wanted to delve more deeply. And then I would ask students to sign up to do a 5-minute mini report on one of the recommended texts that really attracts them. So in answer to your question, maybe you could get people to do 2, 3, 5-minute presentations individually in which you could do some kind of critique. It's not going to be as good as doing it face to face, but there's a lot you can do with audio video.
Howard, before we got started, you talked a little bit about kind of some of the downsides of being a remote participant in online communities, and just I thought it was an interesting thing as something to kind of like be aware of.
Well, I don't know how far that this extrapolates to the classroom, but of course you're only seeing what people present of themselves, what they want you to see of themselves in most online discussions, communities. There's always an adjustment when you meet someone face to face who you've known exclusively online, and I think that there are trust issues that come with that, or there should be trust issues that come with that. So I think you always need to do some getting acquainted and trust building exercises. Of course, in a classroom, people meet each other face to face. They may not know each other outside the classroom. If you're going to have an online class and you're going to have a video session like this, it pays to have the learners introduce themselves, 20 or 30 second introduction, just so you can see them, get a sense of them, hear their voice. Most teachers don't really have a choice usually about the size of their course. It's really ideal online to have a cohort of 15 to 30 people. You can fit all those video thumbnails onto a desktop screen, if not a smartphone screen, and it's few enough people that everyone can take 30 seconds to introduce themselves and people can get to know each other. You know what they do in universities with large courses. You lecture to 300 people, and then you've got teaching assistants who each take a section of 20 or 30 students. So you may need to do that. Of course, a teacher cannot do the same presentation 10 times for 20 people if they got 30 students. So you've got to work around that. If you're going to have teaching assistants who are facilitating online discussions, whether they're synchronous or asynchronous, they too need to know what they're doing, have some training. It may be that some of your students are better at social media than you are, and always pays to listen to them.
Sure. We have another question. In person, social norms help deliver the expected experience with near instant feedback. Asynchronous interactions don't provide that feedback in the same way. Do you have any advice on how to build a culture for the classroom workspace?
Well, I'll just underline what I've said already, that I really think that one of the great strengths of having both synchronous audio and video and asynchronous multimedia, forums and or sometimes called discussion boards are no longer just text. You can post a meme, you can post a video or a graphic just as well, and people do, and students, my students, college students like to to do that, it gives you a sense of presence. It enables you to have a thing about a conversation is that we pick up on each other's cues and we ask questions and we clarify things. That operates at a much slower pace, if at all, asynchronously. And there are advantages to asynchronous in that there are, I think every teacher can tell you that there are students in the class who are just as smart and study just as hard, but they're not great at speaking extemporaneously when they're put on the spot in the classroom and everybody's looking at them. If they're sitting in their dorm room or at home and they have time to think about it, they can have a thoughtful response. So another reason why I like to use multiple media is that some people are better at some than others. And I think you need to be open to that. If people want to make videos or make GIFs or memes or come up with something other than your normal curriculum, but comes from their experience, you should fit that in.
One of the things that I've noticed about kind of online meetings, online collaboration, is that kind of the if there's a teacher or the project leader, they have to pay attention to more things than simply the discussion. Like just the discussion you and I are having right now, I'm looking at questions, people are asking comments to make sure that that gets fed back into the conversation. Is there a good way from your experience to deal with the fact that it's more than just you and I talking? There's an audience we have to be aware of. There's kind of a performative aspect to it. And then just this kind of paying attention to many different things happening at the same time. How do you do it?
Well, I'm a person who likes to multitask. that's not true of everybody. So I can't read an active chat like this one and talk simultaneously, but I can look over at it once in a while, see something. Like, for example, upstream, some people said, well, can we do some of those roles here? I had time to say, well, self-organize. I really haven't time to look back to see whether people have self-organized, but certainly people are searching out and putting URLs into the chat. And so I saw that and I just asked, is somebody going to collect and contextualize them? I think that they could send those to you, and IFTF could include that on a page with the link to the recording of this session. If you're not really comfortable looking over at the chat from time to time while you're talking, why not appoint an assistant to ping you from time to time and as you're doing now, and mm-hmm. say, there's a question from the chat. Again, I think I keep coming back to this. It's not a one-person show. It really needs to involve the whole classroom. Now, I'm a believer in co-learning and that this should happen in the face-to-face classroom as well. But I think it's really a necessity online. You need to involve people. Otherwise, just record your lecture and put it up on YouTube.
Right.
So again, we're being forced to do this. Many teachers are being forced to do this, but I also see this as an opportunity to open up the learning about how to do it. Now, I'll have to say that you'll see that in the chat here. There are many educators who know how to do what I'm talking about, and they are they're offering their best advice on this. I think that there's a wealth of material that's just been created in a couple of days, but wouldn't it be useful if colleges and universities had some kind of basic training for their instructors in case this happened again? And again, I think this is an opportunity. I personally got out of this business 20 years ago, but it's an opportunity for someone to put together the expertise and the information technology to offer services for planning and implementing an online conference for a face-to-face conference that's been canceled. As I said in the document, it takes some planning. And you know what? You could make some good money at that, and it would be a fraction of the cost of what event organizers are faced with these days.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that I've found about online collaboration is that we're kind of trying to emulate previous media. So in some ways, this is almost like a talk show or a podcast where I feel this need to fill dead space with talking all the time to keep everybody interested and entertained. Is that something that eventually you can get used to, so that there is just silence for a while we're looking at questions people are asking or referring to other material that we want to bring into the conversation? Is that something that eventually people come to accept in an online classroom environment, that they're, that it isn't a performance?
Well, you know, something that works for me a lot in the face-to-face classroom is just at the right point, just shutting up there and standing there and waiting. And silence kind of drives people to speak. Online, you sort of have to say, you know what, I'm gonna give you some space to ask questions, or what questions do you have, or who has a comment on this, and then just be silent. Knowing how to shut up is something that every teacher needs to practice, of course.
I have a question here, and this is referring to the essay on Patreon that you just posted, which was really good. Marina wants to know if you could talk more about the kinds of roles that you assign to people in your online classes. You mentioned that briefly, but go into a little more depth about that, because I think that would apply also to online meetings as well.
Well, you know, there's a lot of knowledge and lore, particularly when we're talking about things like social media, with the learners, with the students, and the people who are participating in the chat here, who are watching this video, they know a lot. It's not just us. So I can see that a lot of people are putting some really great links into the text chat. Some people are mentioning who are good leaders in the field. I asked the question, I didn't check for the answers. Is there one or two people who are going to take these URLs out of the chat, write two or three sentences contextualizing them, and then who would they send them to? Would they send them to IFTF or someone at IFTF? I will leave that to you, Mark. And then anybody wants to do a graphic recording or a mind map of what we're talking about, that could be included as well. A lexicon, the words that we're using could be made into a lexicon. So a lot of the roles that I mentioned, the searchers, contextualizers, the page masters, the lexicon makers, the mind mappers, you know, that's all up to the people who are participating in the chat here to organize themselves. I think that there's a wealth of knowledge beyond what you and I have said that's embedded in the chat here, and that we can harvest that and present it in a more permanent form for people. And I think you have to think of if you're teaching, each session, each live session ends up on a web page, so that if you miss the class or you want to replay it, there's a video. If you want to dive more deeply and take a look at those URLs that the searchers have found, that's there for you. The transcript of the chat is available, the lexicon. If individuals have mind maps, then you put that up on a page and you link to that as well. So it's really a more of a community exercise, and that the presenter is as much a facilitator of a kind of collective sense making, I think even more so than they are in the classroom.
Is there one single platform that you're aware of or recommend that kind of has everything that you're talking about, synchronous, asynchronous, indexed archives of the conversation, speech to text transcription.
Well, here's an opportunity. Now, of course, we've got all kinds of platforms. We're using Zoom, there's WebEx, Big Blue Button, there's a lot of different platforms. There are what they call learning management systems, and many of these universities are asking their teachers to use their LMS, as they're called. In my opinion, the learning management system is really mostly useful administratively. It's good for, you know, organizing a class, putting up a syllabus, registering students, taking roll, giving grades. They do have affordances for conversation, but in my experience, they're not as good as a good forum or a good blog. So in 2008, I entered a competition at Haystack, organization of educators had, and I won a small award that I paid a developer to create what I call the social media classroom, which was browser-based. Once you logged into this, you had one tab for the forum, one tab for the blogs, one tab for the mind maps, and you could switch from each one to the other with ease and without having to sign on to another one. We created this in 2008, so it's really obsolete now. I have a really detailed specification in my head of what a social media classroom ought to be. It would cost a couple of tens of thousands of dollars, probably, for hire developers to create it. So if somebody wants to create that, I'd be happy to tell you what's needed. I think ideally, it would largely consist of open source, free and open source tools. So Discourse and Caucus, for example, are web-based forums, discussion boards that are free and open source. If you've got the IT and the chops to do that, WordPress is as well. Wikis are what I started with for collaborative documents, but most of my students prefer to use GDocs. That's what they use. Whatever it is that you need for a collaborative document, that ought to be included as well. But I think one great boon to this whole field would be to have a free or inexpensively hosted social media classroom that's available to people. Again, an opportunity. There was a boom in startups creating edu-type applications, and most of them really didn't appeal to me. You know, there are a couple of them. There's Piazza is one that comes to mind that do have more of these affordances for conversation. But again, the platforms for online learning really are better for the teachers than they are for the students.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my wife Carla is taking an online Japanese language course through Brigham Young University, and I think the platform is something that Adobe made. And every time she has to have some video interaction, she pulls her hair out trying to figure out how to get it to work. And there's like tons of different windows around, and it's not clear what's doing what. If that's the best that's out there, I think you're right. There is a huge opportunity.
And there should be a tab that says how to, and you should have some screenshot by screenshot descriptions of how to use these things. As I said before, everyone knows how to use a textbook. Everybody knows how to use a classroom. You cannot assume widespread knowledge of how to use online tools. It's not that they're that hard. It's that most people don't have a context for them.
Yeah. And what's maddening also is if you pull down a menu and several of the things you want to do are grayed out, you should be able to just like hover over that grayed out menu item and have it explain what to do to get it not grayed out anymore. That's just like a personal pet peeve of mine.
Well, you know, I think this is an example of the fact that the knowledge, the lore that we're talking about, it's not secret. You know some of it. I know some of it. Everybody in this text chat know some of it. It has not been the business of educational institutions to disseminate that knowledge to their teachers. For the most part, educational institutions, especially the big knowledge factory institutions, are really invested in the you know, thousands of years old model of the lecturer and the student. And I think they're being prodded a little bit in normal times to explore blended learning. Now, as I said, they're throwing their teachers in the water. I think just relying on the LMS that they've used for administering their classrooms is not enough. And I don't think you have to take a full college course if you are an instructor to learn to use online media effectively. And you know, teachers already work a lot and they're not being paid to spend more hours learning how to do these new media. The institutions ought to go part of the way to help them with that.
Yeah. I know that virtual meetings are not really your area of expertise, but I thought this was an interesting question because it was something we talked about a little earlier. Somebody said, any thoughts on always on type of virtual office tools that would enable typical office interactions, desk mates, conference rooms, ad hoc water cooler conversations, et cetera. Is that something that can be replicated online?
Well, you know, it's a lightweight substitute for the water cooler is Slack. And I look at it that way rather than a substitute for a forum. It is asynchronous and it does somewhat structure conversations and they are somewhat permanent, but really it's like an asynchronous chat room in a sense. So Slack is easy. Most professors are required to spend as many hours a week in office hours as they do teaching classes. So they sit in their office and students do or don't come by. There's nothing easier than having office hours online. And you have that window open. And when you see somebody in there, then you can talk with them. And I think the immense value of that is that you can it's the same value as office hours. You can have one-on-one conversations with your learners. And there's one thing I learned at colleges, it's that so many students don't really take advantage of their faculty. You know, these universities get these great brand names because in part they've got this great faculty, and then students go to the lectures and they go to the sessions, but they don't go to the office hours. They're a little bit intimidated and they're afraid it's going to affect their grade. I can't think of an instance where going to office hours is going to diminish your grade. It's just going to enable you and the professor to have a more personalized conversation about the material. And the same thing goes for online office hours. In fact, you know, I think the distancing that online office hours versus face-to-face office hours might be useful in a sense, is that it's a little less intimidating.
Mm-hmm. Here's a good question from Katie. We facilitate meetings, design thinking meetings, where participants are encouraged to move around, use post-it notes on flip charts and large boards, either in small groups or large groups. Any suggestions for online workshops?
Well, you know, I don't know about Zoom. I presume Zoom has breakout rooms, but other platforms that I've used, like Big Blue Button, has breakout rooms. So you can, you know, there's an exercise I learned from Kathy Davidson called Think, Pair, Share that's useful face-to-face, and I think is useful online in that you say, okay, I want you to pair up, and I want you to take 1 minute to list the most important things, most important issues that we want to talk about today. And then I want you to spend, as individuals, you know, and then I want you to pair up, and each of you've got a list of six. I want you to pair that two lists of 12 down to one list of three. So you have a conversation for another minute or two, very, very quickly. And then the people report out. in my case, I used those to really shape the teams for the entire term. But you could have breakout rooms, take a 15-minute break or a 5-minute break and do a short exercise. And I think that's a good way of mixing it up so that people work with different people for short periods of time, and they're not under the pressure to create an essay or a term paper. It's just a little exercise and a little chunk of knowledge, and we put all of our little chunks of knowledge together and we talk about making meaning by connecting the dots. So again, you break up into small groups, and then the large group tries to make sense of it.
Another thing we talked about earlier, Howard, is you talking about how the fact that we have this urgency to develop these tools and practices for online collaboration could result in a kind of profound change in society that has some positive benefits. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Well, the main positive benefit is the carbon emissions. We spend a lot of time driving back and forth, flying to conferences. As I said before, if 1 in 5 people who work in an office was to work at home 1 day out of 5, that would be a significant reduction. And you know what? You might even see that in traffic. Having thousands of people travel on jet planes and spend 3 or 4 days together in a large conference rooms, well, clearly you don't want to do that when you're having social distancing during a pandemic, but it's also expensive and burns a lot of fuel. What if 1 in 5 of those giant conferences was to have, you know, maybe several smaller online conferences every year? Wouldn't that do some good? So I think we're being forced to do this. Let's use the opportunity to try to ratchet a little bit of online work, online conferences, online teaching into the future. Again, I'm not presenting this as a replacement. But I think we've got to find some substitutes for the things that require us to move matter around in large quantities.
Yeah, I agree with that. And it's just interesting that face-to-face, unmediated interactions are becoming, we're already precious. You can't replicate them. They'll become increasingly precious, these kinds of things. There will always be a place for them, though. Do you think that there will always be some kind of element to face-to-face collaboration that has value that can never be replicated, no matter what technological developments arise to address that?
You know, again, we have at least a million years of our species learning how to suss out others, you know, by their presence. So physical co-presence is a big deal. I'm forgetting the name of the person who wrote it at the moment, but someone who wrote a book about teaching, kind of the almost on the woo-woo side of it, saying that every classroom has a kind of an invisible field, and it's up to the teacher to try to manage that invisible field. And I think that field in the classroom, well, you know, one example I'll use is something that I learned, I didn't invent, was move your chairs in a circle. The field you create is very different. When you've got rows and columns, people are standardized parts in rows and columns. Also, they're all looking forward. There's a back row. In a circle, there's no back row, and people are looking at each other. And when the teacher sits down in the circle, it kind of flattens that power hierarchy. And there, if you're going to do co-learning, you need to flatten that power hierarchy. a little bit. You know, I tell the students that I learned this somewhere. I didn't invent it. If you were to take a soldier from 1,000 years ago and put them on a battlefield today, they would die right away. If you take a surgeon from 1,000 years ago and you put them in a modern surgical operating theater, they wouldn't really know what to do. If you took students from 5,000 years ago and you put them in a modern classroom, everyone would know where to sit and everyone would know who's in charge. I think we need to kind of cede some of that authority. You can't cede all of it. I mean, my grade of you, the student, is more important than your evaluation of me, the teacher, and we're never going to change that. I hate grades. That's another subject. If we could eliminate grades, that would help a lot. But if you're going to have people be co-learners and co-teachers, you have to say, you know, I'm going to give up a little bit of my teacher power to you, and in return, I want you to take a little bit more responsibility for your learning. You're not just going to sit there and take notes. You're going to help formulate the curriculum, and I think in the face-to-face classroom that's much more easily handled in terms of, again, that field. You know, people get to know each other a little bit in a classroom if they don't know each other elsewhere. Mm-hmm. There's kind of a sum of our body language that's happening in a classroom, and you know, a good teacher can tell when things are flagging or when people need some explanation. And I think that's always going to be important. But as I said, in my classrooms, well, we've got YouTube now. Why should I stand here and talk for an hour? I'll just put that on YouTube and then let's have a conversation about that. And you know, the notion of the flipped classroom for a lot of classes, not for all of them, is that you put your lectures online, you spend your face-to-face time solving problems together, collaborating together, having conversations together. So it will always be important to be co-present, but I just don't think it's 100%. And I think there's a lot that we can do online.
Howard, I like that you gave the suggestion to all of the people who are participating in this with us to self-organize. And it looks like Leticia has put together a Google Doc with all the links that have been contributed so far in the chat. So that's fantastic. And I think that would be a great place for people to get started if they're interested in learning about other tools and practices for online collaboration.
Absolutely. And you know, before we wrap this up, if some people want to volunteer to do the contextualization of writing a couple of sentences around each link on that document, that'll make it even better. If someone wants to copy the chat transcript and you know, put that somewhere, that would be good. And then, you know, presumably at IFTF, someone will put all these things together with a link to the recording, and we'll have a living multimedia document that has a lot of knowledge in it that people can access quickly. That's the advantage of text. Or if they miss the session and they want to really get the deep dive, then they can replay it. I think that's, you know, a great advantage. Most classes don't record their classroom sessions, and you know, they don't need to. With online, there's always going to be someone who misses it, and you know, sometimes there are people who want to go back.
Yeah, sure. And we're doing our part at IFTF by creating a page that's going to have a link to this recorded conversation that we had, as well as other links that we've collected. So we'll have a link to Leticia's document. It's at iftf.org/online-collaboration-series, all smushed together, one word, iftf.org/online-collaboration-series. And this was episode 1 of a series that we plan to do, and it was a great way to kick it off with someone that I have been a fan of for many decades now, and someone who knows more about this than I think anyone I've ever met. So Howard, thank you so much. It's been really fun talking with you.
Sure, great. And of course, you know, I've been a fan since Boing Boing was on paper.
That's so cool. Yeah, we traded subscriptions. I think you were the one who initiated that.
Yeah.
Boing Boing for Whole Earth Review. Very cool. Howard, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thanks. Take care.
Yeah, and thanks everyone else for joining. That was a large audience of folks. And I think one thing that I learned is I would like to see, if possible, your faces next time. I don't know if there's a way to do that. I think that would give a better feeling of who we were talking to and who was asking questions and things like that.
All right.
Okay. Take care. Bye, Howard. Bye, everybody.